Hello everybody, thank you for joining this webinar. My name is Alexandra Martin, I will be the moderator of the session. I'm happy to welcome you to the last webinar of our live series introducing our brand new six-color prism. Today's talk highlights the benefit of crystal digital PCR for environmental and food testing and is presented by Romain Parillot, application specialist at Stila Technologies. Before we start, I would like to introduce the widget you can use to ask your question during the presentation. You simply have to type your question in the window on the right of your screen and click send to submit it. We will collect your questions during the talk and answer them in the Q&A session at the end. If questions remain unanswered, we will provide the answer thanks to the contact information you gave when you registered. Now, I will hand over to Romain and enjoy the talk.
Thank you, Alexandra. So, hi everyone. I'm really pleased to welcome you for the last session of the June webinar series. And the talk of today will be regarding benefits of crystal digital PCR for environmental and food testing. So, as a brief overview of the presentation of today, I will first introduce the principle of digital PCR. In the second part, I'm going to show you the development of a highly multiplexed assay for GMO screening and quantification, and show you how using crystal digital PCR is an advantage on regular qPCR for GMO detection in complex matrix. Finally, in the last part, I will introduce our next innovation, the six-color reader, and how suitable it is for screening, identification, and quantification of GMO. So, let's start by a brief overview of the principle of digital PCR. Digital PCR is the third generation of the well-known polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. First generation of PCR is based on amplification of a target and to detect whether the amplicon is present or not on an electrophoresis gel. Then came quantitative PCR, where the amplification is monitored during the amplification cycles. qPCR results are given in CT value, which is not a result by itself, requiring the use of standard curves or reference gene to obtain a concrete result. On the contrary, digital PCR allows an absolute quantification, meaning each point is a result in copy per microliters. So no standard curves are needed anymore. Digital PCR also allows an increased sensitivity and a higher precision. So, for digital PCR, as in qPCR, you prepare your samples and your master mix. And the first step will be to divide your bulk of measurement in many thousands of droplets of the same size. This step is the partitioning and will dilute the genetic complexity of your sample. As the partitions are generated, the target sequences are randomly distributed in the droplets, such that some droplets will contain one or more target of interest, and some won't contain any target of interest. Then we can start the PCR, leading to the generation of the fluorescence signal in all droplets that initially contain the target. In the right panel, you can see a dot plot showing the fluorescence intensity on the y-axis, and where each dot is representing a droplet. We can observe two clusters, the positive droplet on top and the negative cluster down. When the fraction of positive and negative droplets determined, applying the Poisson law will allow us to calculate the concentration of the target of interest together with an uncertainty of the measurement coming from this Poisson law. So now I'm going to briefly introduce you to our workflow at Stila Technologies. So the Sapphire chip is the only consumable needed in the Naika system workflow. The Sapphire chips contain 4 wells already pre-filled with oil. Then you just need to add 25 microliters of your sample and mix into the white cap inlet that you can see. And it is a patented partitioning technology inside the Sapphire chip called the droplet crystals. The Sapphire chips are going to generate up to 30,000 droplets per sample, and the droplet volume being 0.59 nanoliters. Once the sample loaded in the chips, you place your chip in the Nika geode. The Nika geode can receive up to 3 chips, meaning up to 12 samples per run with one geode. The first step, once it's a geode, is an increase of pressure, leading to a contactless fluid injection pushing the sample towards the microfluidic in the chips and generating the droplets with a tightly controlled size, as you can see on the video here. Directly after the partition, the PCR amplification starts within the same instrument as in a regular PCR instrument. Once amplification done, finally, we place the chip in the prism imaging system to read the droplet's fluorescence. The reading is assessed in 10 minutes in 3 different channels, so the blue, the green, and the red, allowing to easily multiplex 3 targets. The specification of each channel, as you can see, allows you to read your favorite fluorophore as used in qPCR, for example. Finally, our software, Crystal Miner, integrates all the droplet fluorescence, allowing an easy analysis of the results within the different channels. Crystal Miner is available with no limitation on seats or licensing fees and can be downloaded together with demo data via Stila Technologies website. So to sum up on the Nika system workflow, it allows you to get your result in around 2.5 hours with a minimum hands-on time. And the integration of the whole workflow within the Sapphire chips make it really easy to use. So we are now moving at the second part of the presentation of today. With a highly multiplexed assay for GMO detection that has been developed on the Nika free color reader in collaboration with Biotechon Diagnostics. So the majority of countries around the globe have imposed a legislation that regulates the use of GMO, which usually includes a labeling system. In the European Union, the threshold for labeling all food and feed products that contain authorized GMO is set at 0.9% per ingredient. Also, for unauthorized but tolerated GMO, the threshold is set at the technical zero tolerance limit of 0.1% in feed per GM lines. So with GMO testing and according to the legislation, there are always 3 main questions to be addressed. Does the sample contain GMO material? If it would be the screening part. And finally, if yes, which GMO is present and does it have an approval? It would be the identification. And if it is approved, how high is the relative content? It will be the quantifications here. Here you can see a typical Tachman detection assay designed for GMO detection. With a specific amplification of a GMO targeted here by a blue probe, and using another probe targeting an endogenous gene, here with a green probe, we can define the total amount of DNA material and calculate the total GMO content of the samples with this classical Tachman detection assay. So here, in a collaboration with Biotechon Diagnostics, we developed a highly multiplex detection and quantification assay for 14 GM soybean events, all target within the same blue channels. We also targeted the soybean lectin endogenous gene to quantify the amount of this event. So in this way, with this assay, using just one assay, we are able to screen all these GM events in only this one assay and discriminate if the sample tested is GMO-free or not for labeling. So to develop this highly multiplexed assay, we first tested the mixture on each GM event independently. So for that, we spike one of each GMO event at 1% into DNA extracted from GMO free soy flour. You can see for each column delimited by a light gray dashed line, the different GM event tested separately in the blue channels. We can also observe a nice positive droplet population in the blue channels for each GM event tested. We can also see in the right the lectin endogenous genes in the green channels. So then we confirm the capacity of this highly multiplex assay to detect and quantify accurately together multiple GM events combined at the same time. So we compared GMO content using singleplex versus multiplex. On the left panel, using a spike of MO88 and MO01, giving a total of 87.6% for each singleplex, and the multiplex result is of 88.8, so really close to the singleplex. So the same result. And also on the right, you can see that we use soyflor 1 and soyflor 2, containing both different levels of different GM events. And you can see again that we will obtain the same total content in the multiplex than in the sum of the GMO content for each singleplex. So this data shown that this highly multiplexed assay allows to test the full GMO content in just one assay. So we then verify the robustness of this assay on a large range of GMO content. And you can see here this dynamic range with a zoom in at low concentration. We observe a great correlation and linearity between measured and observed concentration within the dynamic range of GMO content tested. Finally, we can see the result at the 0.1% zero technical limit essential for the EU legislation. So using the highly multiplex assay and the NICAS system, we could easily reach this 0.1% technical limit with minimal variability here. So then, we tested this assay in challenging food. So the food DNA extracted matrix can be difficult to amplify by regular PCR due to the presence of inhibitor. We challenged here the reliability of this assay to detect GM event in complex matrix. So we spiked MO88 in DNA extracted of non-difficult to amplify food matrix like chocolate desserts, chocolate milk, or tofu with herbs. So we can see where no DNA is spiked, we do not obtain any signals. But there is a clear distinction between positive and negative droplets when MO88 is spiked in a chocolate dessert or tofu with herbs. And we can see also as well that for lectin 1, a nice separability also between the positive and negative population and droplets, even if tested in complex DNA food extracted matrix. So indeed, digital PCR shows inherent tolerance to PCR inhibitor. At Stila R&D tested same concentrations of DNA in qPCR and in digital PCR with different concentration of humic acid, a well-known PCR inhibitor present in soil. In qPCR, with already 50 micrograms per microliter, we can observe a large bias in the quantification, passing from 1,600 copies to 900 copies per microliter. And we can see that the quantification, there is almost no quantification using 100 micrograms per microliter of humic acid. And on the contrary, for digital PCR, with an endpoint analysis using 50 or 100 micrograms per microliter of humic acid won't impact the quantification. As you can see, the separation between positive and negative droplets will be impacted by the inhibitor. But as long as the separability is correct enough to separate these two populations, the quantification will still be really accurate in crystal digital PCR. Here is another graph. You can see on the y-axis the percentage of inhibition in qPCR and crystal digital PCR induced by humic acid or heparin, another well-known inhibitor of PCR. So in qPCR, we can see that qPCR is really quickly inhibited as the concentration of humic acid or heparin is increasing compared to digital PCR, which is much more tolerant toward these PCR inhibitors. This, as we saw, due to the digital endpoint, digital PCR endpoint data acquisition. So we have just seen with this second part that crystal digital PCR allows an easy and robust screening and quantification of GM events for GMO labeling, in this case with this highly multiplexed assay. Though in EU legislation, if food or feed contain GM events, it's needed to be able to identify and quantify separately each of these GM events. So I am now pleased to introduce our latest innovation at Stila Technologies, the six-color crystal digital PCR. Here, in collaboration with NIB, I'm going to show you how having six colors is an advantage for GMO detection for the screening, the quantification, and the identification all at once. So, with the six-color reader, the setup is identical as the three-color workflow. One pipetting step to load the Sapphire chips, then the Nika geode to perform the partitioning and thermal cycling. The difference is now in the number of colors the reader can read that has been doubled from 3 to 6 colors. Of course, we still have our fully integrated software to analyze your result in an easy and intuitive manner. So, the six-color crystal digital PCR can use a wide range of fluorophores as in qPCR multiplexing. Listed here are examples of compatible fluorophores. However, this is not an exhaustive list. The six-color reader is compatible with our Sapphire chips and our soon-to-come Opal chips, allowing you to run up to 36 samples or 144 samples per day, respectively, with one gel. Time to result will be conserved in, for the six colors workflow below 3 hours. So with the NIB, we developed a Crystal Digital PCR six color assay to quantify and identify 5 GM events, as well as the endogenous lectin gene LIM1 in a single assay to obtain a percentage content of 5 of these GM events. You can see here the different assays with the fluorophore associated for each GM event. Also, on the 1D plot, we can observe a really nice separability between negative and positive droplets for each of these GM events tested here. So the NIB tested then serial dilutions in a large range of concentration to check the linearity of each GM event within the six-plex assay. You can see here a really nice linearity over the range of concentration tested with an R square above 0.99 using 8 replicates per dilution. Also here, you can see we tested more dilution at lower concentration, showing again here a great correlation and linearity at low concentration. So the six-color Crystal Digital PCR has a potential for very high multiplexing quantification, even in very complex samples such as GMO testing in food matrix. So to conclude, the NAICA system is a time and cost-effective solution to screen, quantify, and identify GMO. Crystal Digital PCR is ideal for PCR inhibitory matrix analysis. And our new innovation, six-color capability, will allow high multiplexing for quantification, screening, and identification of GMO events. This, which is important in terms of GMO, which are increasing every year with new GMO, it's important to place in front technologies allowing these high multiplexing possibilities. So thank you for your attention, and now Alexandra is going to take your question.
Yes, thank you, Romain, for the very clear presentation. So we got a few questions during the presentation. You can still ask questions, so don't hesitate to type in your question. Okay, so the first question will be, will the workflow timing be the same between 3 and 6 colors?
Yes, indeed, the time of the workflow will be exactly the same between both workflow.
Okay, next question, what are the challenges you faced while designing a high multiplexing assay?
So with the NIB or with biotech on diagnostics, the major difficulties to generate high multiplexing assay will be the interaction between the different primers, all the primers and probes that can interact together. And the more targets you will have, the more complex it will be. In terms of interaction between this primer and probes. So it will be important to have an in silico analysis that this primer won't interact when designing this kind of assay.
Okay, next question relates to inhibitors. Could you explain more about how digital PCR is inherently resistant to inhibitors?
So as I was showing during the presentation, digital PCR is an endpoint analysis, meaning if your PCR inhibitors are affecting your efficiency of your PCR, you will see a decrease of separability between the positive and negative cluster. But still, as long as you can place a threshold between the positive and negative droplets population, you will obtain an accurate quantification.
Okay. So the next question, with your technology, would you be able to detect non-authorized nor tolerate GMOs?
So it would be a new GMO. So this technology is already targeted, is already a targeted approach, meaning you need your primer and your probes. It means you need to know the sequence you are looking for. So you will be looking at authorized at GMO where you know the sequence. If it's totally new GMO, non-authorized, you might not be able to detect them. Yeah.
Okay. And the last question for now is, how can we be sure there are no false positive or false negative droplets with the NICA system?
So here will be during the design of the assay. You have to determine your limit of blank, limit of detection, limit of quantification for each assay. And here you will, by doing this, you will make sure that you won't have false negative, false positive in your assay. So for that, you have to run many, around 30, 40 different negative samples to make sure that your assay is really, really clean and that you won't have any false positive droplets and so on.
Okay. So I think that was the last question flowing, yes. So with that, we will thank you again for your attention. And we are available on social media and also by email at support@stila.ch for any more questions.
Thank you.